our animal ordinance. I should just say animal ordinance and not pit bull. Roll call.
Alderperson Morissette.
Here.
Alderperson Vanzel.
Here.
Alderperson Weber.
Here.
All right, I just want to say one thing to everybody and that's here is that this meeting is in fact for addressing the issue of our ordinance and how it's written and what we're going to discuss, and discussing that this is for the public safety and the well-being of the Hudson community. This is not for a specific breed. So I just want to make it very clear, we're going to discuss our options and possibly rewriting and restructuring our ordinance to accommodate what we think is the best for the safety and well-being of the Hudson community. So with that, Marty, do you want to start off, or I'm going to have Mary Pat Finnegan with the PowerPoint start?
I think if Mary wants to go with the PowerPoint, I believe there's two groups that would like to present. So, and then I think there's several people that wanted to at least weigh in.
How many people really want to speak?
How many people want to speak tonight? One, two, three?
Okay.
Four? So about four. So let's try to limit the time so we're all not here all night and we can, it's easier to get our points across if we don't ramble on like I'm doing now. So, Mary Pat, if you are ready, give us your name and address, and that's for everybody that comes to the podium. And you can start with your presentation.
My name is Mary Pat Finnegan. I live at 1025 6th Street in Hudson. I'd like to thank the council members for allowing me to appear before the Public Safety Committee tonight. During the summer, I generally walk 5 to 7 miles a day around Hudson. On July 19th, while walking on the path near the river, my dog Moofy was attacked not once but twice by a pit bull. That morning, as I made my statement to the police, I watched as my son and husband lifted and carried our battered and bleeding dog into our van before racing him to our vet. Moofy is a beloved member of our family, and he is the reason I began looking deeper into this issue. I have to say it has been a real education. I have been saddened by the many reports of those who have lost their beloved pets when dangerous dogs have attacked. I am sickened by the stories of dogs attacking people, especially since a disproportionate amount of the victims are children. Far too many people have lost their lives in vicious attacks, and many more will forever bear the scars of their encounter with a dangerous dog. It seems that breed-specific laws may be difficult to pass and enforce, so I've taken a different tack. The PowerPoint I will show outlines the definition of dangerous dogs and the suggested laws regarding those animals. I have not reinvented the wheel here. I have looked at what other cities across the country and the world have on the books regarding this contentious, polarizing issue, and I took what I thought were the best, most common sense laws and compiled them as a suggested list for the city of Hudson. And if I could, this is pretty brief, if I may show this. So on July 18th, I posted on my Facebook page, love our morning walks on the dike by the St. Croix, and this is kind of hard to see, but that's my dog, Moofy, my constant companion on my walks. And this is very hard to see, I'll read this. Many of you have this. This morning, as Moofy and I walked by the river, he was viciously attacked by a dog that looked like a pit bull. I tried to protect Moofy as the dogs, a pit bull, and I believe it was a Great Pyrenees, raced towards him. But the pit bull immediately grabbed Moofy by the throat and flipped him on his back. I hit and kicked the dog repeatedly to get him to let go. And when his owner finally caught up with him and pulled him away, she was able to hold him for only a moment before he went after Moofy again. What ensued was Moofy running away with the pit bull snarling and biting him until he once again grabbed him by the throat and wrestled him to the ground. The other woman reached them before I did and was able to once again grab her pit bull. I was able to get Moofy across the street but couldn't find where he was bleeding because the big stupid dog was all over Moofy. As I called 911, she asked what I was doing. When I replied, "I'm calling the police," she was incredulous. "We don't need the police," she kept saying. "He's a rescue dog. He's in training." Obviously, training for them is not working because the woman had no control over either of her dogs. I know that I will get replies that pit bulls are sweet dogs and what a noble thing it is to rescue a dog. But pit bulls or any dog who shows aggressive tendencies do not belong with irresponsible owners. I cannot help thinking of this and what would have happened had the pit bull gotten a hold of Oscar, Mufi's friend, a small Yorkshire terrier we also met on our walk that morning, or Belle, a small chocolate lab, another of Mufi's friends that was also on the trail that morning. Mufi suffered many injuries. His back toenails were also ripped out. The vet says he must have been running for his life, a fact that I can attest to. We are blessed that Mufi will be okay, but there are so many questions. What if it had been a child or one of the old guys I see riding their bikes in the morning that this dog went after? Why was this dog, obviously not a puppy, a rescue dog? Has he attacked before? Can anyone pick up a rescue dog? Aren't there some requirements for owners? Aren't there muzzle laws for vicious, aggressive dogs? The woman kept asking me, "What do you want?" What I want is to be able to take a walk with my dog without having to worry about him getting attacked. Mufi is family, and I thought we were going to lose him that morning. So this just shows some of his injuries. You all have the PowerPoint. So the proposed changes. The current law says every fierce or vicious animal shall be confined within a building or secure enclosure, and the owner shall not take such animal out of building or enclosure unless muzzled and or leashed. So, and then there is a section that pertains especially to pit bulls and the enclosures that they need to be in. I think the first step is to define what is a fierce, vicious, or dangerous animal. The most common sense definition that I came across was any dog that, when unprovoked, inflicts bites on a human or domestic animal, either on public or private property, or chases or approaches a person upon the streets, sidewalks, or any public grounds in a menacing fashion or apparent attitude of attack, or any dog with a known propensity, tendency, or disposition to attack unprovoked, to cause injury, or otherwise to threaten the safety of humans or domestic animals. And the changes that I propose, right now, it's tough to enforce the dog license laws in Hudson, but I think with enhanced enforcement, we can augment the animal control budget and help with some of the programs that could be in place. And I understand checking dogs to see if they're licensed is not a feasible use of city resources, either the Hudson Police Department or the animal control officer. However, if a dog matching the description of a dangerous dog is involved in an attack and that dog is not licensed, the penalty should be no less than $100. The next step would be enhanced enforcement of leash dog at large laws with adequate penalties. Again, picking up every dog that is out without a leash is not a feasible use of city resources. However, if a dog matching the description of a dangerous dog is involved in an attack and that dog is not leashed pursuant to the city code, the penalty again should be an additional $100. Enacting dangerous dog laws that are breed neutral and focus on the behavior of the individual dog owner. And many of you have this. Doug, the one change that I did make here is that an animal is securely tethered to a leash, not a retractable leash, no longer than it should be 4 foot in length. Failure to comply would result in a fine of no less than 100. Also, a person should be able to be in charge of the dog. You don't want an 8-year-old who's in charge of minding a very strong, big dog. So the person must be 16 years of age or older, competent to govern the dog and capable of physically controlling or restraining the dog. A dangerous dog on a leash outside the dog's kennel shall be muzzled in a humane way by a muzzling device sufficient to prevent the animal from biting people or other animals. Failure to comply would result in another fine of $100. And I wanted to say, the last couple of weeks, I've had appointments over in Minneapolis, and I've been walking around Lake Harriet. And yesterday, I saw a little Bichon with a muzzle on. So it's just part of being a responsible owner. Obviously, this, you know, I never once felt threatened walking around there. There were, you know, tons of dogs, but never once felt threatened. And then owners should have a sign, beware of dog, if they have a dangerous dog in their household. And all owners of dogs deemed dangerous will be required to provide a current color photograph of the dog with the treasurer's office and provide proof of dog bite liability insurance in an amount not less than $100,000. Failure to comply would result in a misdemeanor charge. Then this last part, I'll just read this. Any dog deemed dangerous that does not meet these leash, muzzling, confinement, adult supervision, signage, and proof of liability insurance laws when in public would face gradually increasing penalties, including mandated sterilization and microchipping at the owner's expense. Dogs involved in an unprovoked attack on a person or another domestic animal. And this part, I would need to check with a veterinarian. I've heard after I wrote this that the quarantine period is actually 18 days, not 10. After that period, dogs involved in an unprovoked attack on another domestic animal will be assessed veterinary bills for the injured animal and fined $500 if the animal is still living, and $5,000 if the injured animal died as a result of the attack. Any person involved in an unprovoked attack by a dangerous dog will have all of their medical expenses paid by the dog's owner. Any dog involved in an unprovoked attack on a person will be euthanized. And then this is, again, my dog. This is the reason why I am doing this fight. Hudson is a great walking town. I enjoy my walks around Hudson very much. The dog rescue organizations in town have been very successful finding homes for pit bulls and pit bull mixed type dogs in Hudson. Take a walk downtown on any given day and you will see this type of dog. I know there are good, responsible, and conscientious owners that are aware that their dog may have unforeseen triggers. I also know it's going to take me a while before I can walk around town with the same sense of security and freedom that I once took for granted. That's it.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Or do you want to keep going with people's comments?
Keep going.
Okay.
Thank you for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you. Next person who wants to talk can come to the podium, state your name and address for the record. Angie, do you have a PowerPoint? Oh, okay. You can start when you're ready.
Sure. First, maybe I'll just say that we're really relieved to know the approach you've taken on this. Our PowerPoint may not be as directly useful to this conversation. I think that we are on the same page with a couple of the major issues. But we did put a lot of time into our cute little PowerPoint. So if it's okay with you, we're going to take, it'll probably take an extra 5 to 8 minutes to review the whole PowerPoint. And we'll use this more of education purpose so that you can have more knowledge when you are asked about breed-specific legislation in the future.
Okay. State your name and address with both of you.
Sure. Ashley Kurtz. My address is 1064 Cottonwood Drive in Hudson, Wisconsin.
Alyssa Prashak, and I live at 2229 Salvia Lane in Hudson.
Okay, thank you.
We're just waiting for our little PowerPoint to show up here.
And just so you guys are aware, I just want you to make sure you direct all your conversations to us.
Okay. The PowerPoint is showing just a little darker than what we were envisioning, so I apologize for that. First off, again, I'm Ashley Kurtz. I am a Hudson resident, and I also am the founder and director of Coco's Heart Dog Rescue. We're a nonprofit organization that is foster-based and has rescued over 1,800 dogs since being founded in 2010. We are an all-breed rescue, including the bully breeds that we were here to defend this evening.
My name's Alyssa Preshock, and I'm just here as a Hudson resident and an advocate for animals in general. This is my dog, Mercedes. She's a loving girl with a fun and silly personality. She's most happy when she can be with children. Mercedes has an instinctual compassion that she expresses through her gentleness and desire to please. She is a rescue that has had an unfortunate past, but that has not changed her love of people and the affection she so willingly shows. Lily, her Papillon sister, is the boss in our house, and Mercedes wouldn't have it any other way.
And then we also just wanted to introduce you quickly to my foster dog, Sparrow, who is a four-year-old pit bull terrier, and one of her good friends, my two-legged chihuahua, Hope, just proof that all friends come in all shapes and sizes. The history of the pit bull terrier. In early America, the dogs were very valued. They were entrusted to protect homesteads from predators and worked as vital helpers on family farms. Homesteaders depended on their abilities to help in hunts and hog. They were constant companions to the young children who were entrusted in their care. Pit bulls earned their place as an important part of the fabric of a developing nation. As cities sprung up, pit bulls remained a prominent part of the American culture. The USA admired this breed for qualities that it likened in itself: friendly, brave, hardworking, worthy of respect. They showed up in hundreds of turn-of-the-century photos, flanked by loving family members. Early advertisements, posters, and magazines began to use the image of the all-American dog, including Buster Brown, whose companion was a pit bull. World War I posters displayed illustrations of American pit bull terriers as proud mascots of neutrality and bravery. This was Sergeant Stubbe's era. The pit bull was also a favorite dog among politicians, scholars, and celebrities. Helen Keller, Theodore Roosevelt, and the R Gang Little Rascals all had pit bulls. Today, this tradition continues with countless numbers of Americans who love and cherish their family pit bulls. Strength, confidence, a sense of humor, and a zest for life are all hallmarks of the breed. Properly socialized dogs are quite affectionate and friendly, even with strangers, and therefore do not make good guard dogs. They're intelligent and eager to please and tend to remain playful throughout their lives. While some can be low-key couch potatoes, many others need a job to channel their enthusiasm and energy. They excel in dog sports, search and rescue work, drug and bomb detection work, and as therapy dogs. Severe shyness, fearfulness, or human-directed aggression is not characteristic of this breed and highly undesirable in any dog.
The breed and description. For the purpose of this presentation, we've used the generic term pit bull to describe our dogs, even though there is no proper definition for pit bull. Recent research, including DNA analysis by Dr. Victoria Voith and others, has proven that dogs commonly identified as pit bulls are quite often a mix of multiple breeds. So breed identification by appearance alone is now considered to be inaccurate and misleading. While large number of pit bull type dogs in this country live out their lives as cherished family companions, Many not so fortunate suffer from the man-made shortcomings, including unspeakable cruelty, the socioeconomic pressures of under-resourced owners, and the relentless biases of discrimination of an ill-informed public. The All-American dog began to be exploited through dog fighting in greater numbers in the 80s and were soon associated with poverty, urban thugs, and crime. The reputation of the entire breed was dragged down with yet more sensationalistic headlines and damaging myths and truth. This set the stage for breed-specific laws, BSL, which cropped up in select places as dogs began to be used as political platform by opportunistic politicians. Dog fighting is now a felony in all 50 states, and arrests have increased, and many now work to restore the dog's image to its rightful place as an American tradition. But even the most responsible owners still struggle to keep their dogs safe from discrimination and harm. The larger threats to the dogs are much more insidious and mainstream than even the threat of dog fighting, and result in an unforgivable prejudice that condemns countless pit bulls to homelessness and an early death. It's ill-informed professionals who promote profiling dogs based on appearance. It's become public policy when lawmakers misuse their positions to remove and destroy innocent pets from their responsible families rather than adopt progressive policies that work to create safe, humane communities. Once again, pit bulls reflect back to us who we are, a culture of incredible contrast and conflicting of beliefs about our roles and responsibility as stewards of our canine companions.
We'll just touch lightly. Again, we wanted to bring up the last information cited from the opposing view was debunked, and we just wanted to remind you that the article called The Problem with Pit Bulls that was published in the Times was quickly followed up with an article called The Problem with People, Not Pit Bulls. Misinformation. Many people believe that pit bulls have locking jaws. Don't be silly. A pit bull's ability to lock on with its jaw is one whopper of a myth that refuses to let go. There is no enzyme, no special mechanism that would make a pit bull's jaws lock. They're dogs, not alligators. If you need proof, after research, Dr. Brisbane of University of Georgia concluded, "We found that the American Pit Bull Terrier did not have any unique mechanism that would allow these dogs to lock their jaws. There were no mechanical or morphological differences." The same silliness shows up with myths about bite pressure. Don't buy into media hype. It'll steer you wrong every time. Bite pressure fact-checking was reported by the National Canine Research Council. Another popular myth, aren't pit bulls mean and vicious? No more vicious than golden retrievers, beagles, or other popular dogs. In yearly tests of over 240 dog breeds by the American Temperament Testing Society, pit bulls consistently achieve a passing rate that's as good or better than other most popular breeds. In the test, a dog is put through a series of confrontational situations. Any sign of panic or unprovoked aggression leads to failure of the test. The achievement of pit bulls in this study disproves once and for all the old tired belief that pit bulls are inherently aggressive to people. Like any breed of dog, a healthy pit bull that is properly raised will reflect the good care his owners have invested with him. Regarding breed-specific legislation, instead of enforcing or considering BSL, it is important to hold the owners responsible. The trend in prevention of dog bites continues to shift in favor of multifactorial approaches focusing on improved ownership and husbandry practices, better understanding of dog behavior, education of parents and children regarding safety around dogs, and consistent enforcement of dangerous dog, reckless owner ordinances in communities. Effective laws hold all breed owners responsible for the humane care and treatment and control of all dogs, regardless of breed or type. And that was directly from the National Canine Research Council. Let's see here. Constitutional rights. The American Veterinary Medical Association's Community Dog Bite Prevention Report states breed-specific ordinances raise constitutional questions concerning dog owners' 14th Amendment rights of due process and equal protection. In addition to lawsuits over constitutional rights, multiple lawsuits have been filed by owners in various cities who claim their dogs were wrongly labeled as one of the targeted breeds. Unfortunately, you can't see these cute pictures we prepared, but there were seven of the dogs that we've had in Coco's Heart Dog Rescue that may have been wrongly identified as a pit bull or pit bull mix, and most of them would surprise you. I think we'll skip that as long as it's not a clear picture. Are you okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
We received stats from Ed Thurman of Environmental Health from St. Croix County, and he provided us some statistics from 2010 to 2014. We picked the most common breeds, the breeds that people would know, as well as the highest numbers. So Labrador Retrievers had 6 bites. That, again, that's from 2010 to 2014. So they had the highest number of bites, followed by Jack Russell Terriers, which had 5. Pitbull Terrier, as well as the Golden Retriever, had 4 bites.
Could you say where you got those stats from
Ed
again?
Ed Thurman from St. Croix County Environmental Health.
We send our, when we have dog bites, we have to send that information to the health department. That's the one that gets coordinates for the whole county.
Okay, thanks.
All right. So this is very similar to what was just proposed. So our current is, every fierce or vicious animal shall be confined within a building or secure enclosure, and the owner shall not take such animal out of the building or enclosure unless muzzled and or leashed. What our proposal is, again, very similar. Every dangerous animal shall be confined within a building or secure enclosure, and the owner shall not take the animal out of such building or enclosure unless muzzled and leashed. This is going to be difficult to read too, but fierce and vicious were not defined in our current ordinances. The definition of a dangerous animal in the proposed ordinance is any animal that inflicts unjustified serious injury or poses an imminent threat of unjustified serious aggression toward a person or other animals. And then D of that ordinance, where it specifically calls out pit bulls, is irrelevant because your leashing laws do cover that in the ordinances 99.5 running at large, A and B. And right now it currently contradicts the current ordinance because it does say muzzled and or leashed. So basically that's open to interpretation, or saying that if the dog is muzzled, it doesn't have to be leashed, which contradicts what we have as A and B here running at large. With saying no cat, dog, or other domesticated animal shall be permitted to run at large within the city of Hudson, and animals considered to be running at large if it is not on the premises of its owner, premise of the owner, and not under the control of the owner or some other person. And B of that is no dog shall be permitted in a public cemetery, playground, schoolyard, public pool, or other posted areas, except when confined within a vehicle or on a leash, or except within written permission of the person in charge. And last, again, agreeing of the fines, it is important that the above ordinances enforced to keep the community safe. It is also important that owners are held accountable for the behavior of their animals. The seriousness of irresponsible ownership should be appropriately cited. Therefore, the fine for failing to comply with these ordinances should be increased from $92.50 for first offense to $200, $124 for second offense, changing that to $250 for the second offense and subsequent offenses.
And in closing, I just want to reiterate that we're thankful that it seems we're mostly on the same page with this. If nothing else, I hope that our presentation on breed-specific legislation opened your eyes to some of the problems it can have if it was considered. Our proposed dangerous dog ordinance will hold owners accountable and promote individual responsibility. And thankfully, it doesn't seem like we have to worry about BSL at the current moment. But if it was ever considered, just know that it will have a negative impact on many great dogs and great people.
Again, just touching on the visual effect of muzzling one breed, which again, it sounds like we're over that piece and we're looking at breed neutral, but just the visual effect of muzzling one breed only creates and enhances a false sense of safety. When you muzzle a dog, it's a visual cue that the dog is not safe, it's scary, and should not be approached. When you apply this to an entire breed, you're inadvertently saying that every other dog is safe, friendly, and approachable, especially to a child. This is a serious issue that needs to be at the forefront of decisions made. This right here would have an adverse effect that would come with some potentially dangerous ramifications. So again, let's work together to accomplish the one goal we all said we were trying to accomplish, which is protecting the safety of our public.
And last but not least, not that you can see it, I was hoping we could all clap. Sparrow was adopted this past week into a great family with children and other dogs. So, all right, thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any questions we can answer?
Nah, not at this point, but stick around. There may be something come up.
Sure. And we do have our sources for our PowerPoint listed here in case you'd like to research any of them.
Thank you. Anybody else that wants to speak? Please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record. If you want to flip that laptop down so we can see. There we go.
Hi, my name is Ellen Lewison. I live at 1127 3rd Street, and I am, along with Ms. Finnegan, I am the irresponsible dog owner. What happened that day is it was horrible. It was traumatic for me and for Mrs. Finnegan, and I'm very sorry this happened to your dog. However, my dog did get loose from her chain, and now I've taken care of that problem. I, as a responsible dog owner, have two leashes on my dog now. One is a choke, and one is a chain. If she breaks the chain, she has another collar on her. She also is muzzled. She also is participating in the Red Star training program for 5 weeks. I'm guaranteed that my dog, when she gets out, will be trained, which you should send your dog also to be trained.
Ma'am, please direct your comments to this committee,
right,
not the audience.
But what I wanted to do mainly here today is to apologize to Mrs. Finnegan for the trouble that I caused, also for the focus on the breed itself. My dog is Shepherd, and she also is a mix of a terrier. She is not, I wouldn't classify her as a pit bull, but she's more Shepherd.
Okay, I'm not sure if you were here at the start of the meeting when I had informed the audience that our direction is to not be breed specific, but to look at our ordinance, mm-hmm, and to move forward in a collaborative way to come up with the best situation for both,
right,
sides of the issue, and that it is the best interest of the general well-being of the Hudson community. It is not going to be breed specific. That is not what we're doing.
I wanted to just say that this incident was unfortunate,
mm-hmm,
was traumatic. I can't go outside myself and feel comfortable because of what happened. And I never want to have a repeat of that situation again, and I'm taking the matters into my hands. And I think other dog owners would probably do the same because they love their animal.
Mm-hmm.
And this was, again, this was dog against dog aggression and not dog against human. And I want to say on behalf of my dog that she had ample opportunity to bite Mrs. Finnegan, and she didn't. She didn't scratch her, she didn't maim her, she didn't rip at her, she didn't bite her at all.
Okay.
So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you for coming down to apologize.
Oh, also, I did pay for Mrs. Finnegan's pet bill for her veterinary services, and I also did call the clinic several times to check up on her animal. She was out of town, and the dog was kenneled there, but I did call to see what the follow-up was with her animal because I was concerned for Muffy, or Muffy, too.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else want? Please come up, state your name and your address for the record, please.
I'm Scott Holmes. I live at 1025 6th Street. I do agree that dog owners are a problem. I think most of us are mediocre dog owners at best. We take our dogs to training. I'd counter 5 weeks is not enough. You got to keep working at it. Some dogs misbehave. They bark. They yip. Other dogs have a propensity to whether it's go after somebody viciously. I disagree with the comment that dog and dog is a less severe thing. I guess it isn't people, but my dog, it's not uncommon for him to go sniff another dog's butt, but he's not at another dog's throat. And I think we need to be very clear that it's not just against people, it's against other animals as well. We could, this breed specific thing, I understand where you're going. If we're protecting, if we have some legislation that's enforceable with the vicious dogs, I'd be on board with that. I think it needs to be a severe enough penalty that deters the behavior. In full disclosure, I am a dog bite victim. I was attacked at the age of 5 by one of these questionable breeds that supposedly don't are the nanny dogs. I have scars, physical scars to show for that. I also have, I had emotional scars for many years. So the notion, and I've been, that you know a poodle or some other dog might bite, that's very true. Some of these dogs are much stronger and have a propensity to latch on longer and do more damage. So I'm okay with the vicious dog definition as it's been described, but it does need to be enforceable. It needs to be, penalties need to be severe enough to prevent this type of behavior. I am intrigued by the notion that once a dog is labeled as a vicious dog, that they're required to carry liability insurance. And I think that's more than the $100 or $200 fine. Most people burn that at a night at the bar downtown. So that's not going to have an impact. But carrying long-term liability insurance every year is something that will get their attention. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments? Yeah. And again, please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. Thank you for taking your time this evening to look at this specific issue. I know it's time out of your usual meeting. My name is Catherine Yammer. I live at 530 Spruce Street, Spruce Drive in Hudson. I experienced an animal bite in our neighborhood, and since that incident, it has changed the entire dynamics in our neighborhood. Children just don't go outside anymore. They go to the door and they say, "I'd really like to go outside, but I think I hear that dog barking." Or, "Can you go outside with me and walk me 3 doors down so that I can get there safely?" If they hear the dog barking and there's 7 or 8 kids outside, they all scream and everyone goes in the house. That's not children being children, and that's not neighbors getting out and being neighborly to one another. I also personally have been chased on my bike on multiple occasions this year by multiple breeds. That doesn't make bike riding as enjoyable as it should in this area of the country. This past weekend, I've also experienced walking at a state park, and I've seen some dogs muzzled and some dogs not muzzled. I can tell you that I felt very confident and very safe when I seen that dog muzzled. And the other thing that I seen was my daughter trying to get on the other side of us away as far as she could from the dogs that were not muzzled. And that instills a fear in her, and I think any of the other children that are ever involved in any type of an animal bite. So earlier somebody said, what do I want? What do you want? What do you want? This is what I want. And this is what I encourage the committee to do, is to look at this ordinance. And we don't want something that's far-reaching and overbearing. We're looking for an ordinance that is more specific and enforceable. We want something that is going to make the irresponsible dog owners accountable for the actions of their dogs. There's many triggers that can make a dog bite or bark or chase. And I think not all the time do these dog owners know what these triggers are, because they could be anything. And if the dog owner has never experienced a trigger for their individual dog, they're going to go by the notion that my dog doesn't bite or my dog is friendly, but they don't know what the trigger is. It's no different with a horse. If a horse gets scared, it's gonna react, and you don't always know what is gonna make them react. And I think that's the issue that we're having in Hudson with these dogs. I want children to be children, and I want the people of Hudson and neighbors, whether they're from River Falls or another state, that come and visit Hudson for the day, they should have the right to be safe here and enjoy this area of the country and not be afraid of whether that dog's gonna bite or whether it might be that one. Thank you for taking the time again to look at this.
Thank you. Any other comments that want to be made? If not,
I just have something for you guys.
Okay.
And I'm not gonna go into defending pit bulls or anything like that. I don't own a dog. You know I'm a cat lady.
Your name and address.
Sorry, Angie Felrath, 807 Green Street, Hudson. I thought it would be useful. Minneapolis and Watertown, Wisconsin are two cities that recently just instilled vicious dog ordinances rather than breed bans or breed specific. So I printed you guys off a copy of both ordinances to give you an idea of what they did with it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And I can email a copy to everybody tomorrow.
Well, is this just one each?
It's just one each.
Okay. Any other comments? If not, we're going to close off the public comment section, and the committee will now start conversating. Who wants to start? Rich? Jim?
Well, I'm really glad to see that everybody's going down the same track of a dangerous dog instead of breed specific, because that's really a messy situation. So that's good to know. I think the question is the level of how are we going to make this enforceable, and how is it going to be painful enough, and then the question I wrote down is, how are we going to communicate this to the people that have dogs? First thought was, well, when they license their dog, give them a copy of the ordinance. But my concern is that I believe that fewer than half the dogs in Hudson are licensed. And I'd like to do some work on that statistic, but when I was campaigning, I visited about 500 houses, and well over half of those houses had dogs. And I'm just betting we don't have that many licenses. So that's the other side of the issue, is how do we communicate it, and how do we get people to even take the basic responsibility of licensing their dog? So we have a huge education issue that goes along with any change that we make here.
Anything?
Yeah, it's definitely about the safety of people, their pets, and being free to walk about the city without, fear of being attacked by another animal. How you legislate that or how you develop an ordinance for that, I guess I'm not totally sure. But I do think there have to be consequences and preventive measures so that people do feel safe. I'm not a pet owner, so I don't know a lot about what goes on with pet owners. The question in my mind is, what's wrong with muzzling all the dogs? What harm does a muzzle create for a dog? And it's not breed specific, it addresses safety, and it goes after the problem. So I don't know, in my mind, I don't know why you would not want to muzzle your dog. And it doesn't have to be any breed specific at all. It's just all dogs in Hudson will be muzzled. They'll be leashed and muzzled, and it takes care of the safety problem.
Let me interject. It
creates a safer environment, and people will not be afraid.
Let me interject on that, not to lose your train of thought, but playing devil's advocate, how would we enforce every dog being muzzled?
Pretty simple to me. If you see a dog that's not muzzled, it's in violation.
Who? Our police department?
Police department, the animal warden. Neighbors can call. People who walk around and see a dog that's not muzzled, just report it. And then put a fine on it.
It would generally have to be self-police, because I'm not comfortable having officers out there specifically looking for muzzled dogs.
No, I don't think we should spend the police time to specifically look for a muzzled dog or unmuzzled dog, but if they're seen, it's an easy situation where if it's not muzzled, it's in violation of our ordinance. That's just how it is.
Okay.
Becomes clean, simple. It's not debatable. You're not going to get into a situation where somebody says, well, it's this specific breed, so it doesn't need a muzzle. It's very clean cut. It's fair to everybody. And it provides safety to the public. We don't have to worry about it.
What parameters would you put on something like that? If the dog's outside, are you talking just as
if you're off your
label?
Property, if you're off your property, your dog has got to be leashed and muzzled. That's basically what the ordinance says right now. It either has to be leashed. If the animal's off the property, it has to be leashed and or muzzled. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, no, it has to be leashed and muzzled.
As a dog owner, I definitely would not support that.
Why not?
Muzzles are horrible things to put on dogs. They really are. There's no comfort in that. The dog is unhappy. I had to do it, and it's not a pleasant thing. So I wouldn't support that as a approach. And I understand that, that's a really easy way to go, but you can paint yourself into a lot of corners that way. We have a few bad actors, and then the whole population has to suffer because of those few bad actors. I can't support that approach. But interesting concept. But.
What would you support, Jim?
I don't know. I think these two versions that we have, first of all, getting a good definition of a dangerous dog, cleaning that up, we really lack that in our current ordinance. There's a lot of vagary in that ordinance, and it's probably why we have a hard time with enforcement, too. Officers could spend a lot of time in court defending an action that's not defensible. So I think that's the first step, is get the definition of what a dangerous dog is, go to non-breed specific. But I think the insurance thing is going to be real interesting, because I know there are times where you can't get insurance with certain breeds of dogs. If you have certain breeds of dogs, you can't get household insurance from many companies. So that's an issue already. So I'm not quite.
And what does that tell you?
Yeah, right. Well, it tells you the minimum thing it tells you is the insurance company believes that's an issue. Now, the information that we're being presented is maybe it's not, maybe it's not totally true. But what are their statistics that they base that on? I'd like to see those two ordinances there and see how they dealt with that, because I think it's definitely the right way to go, is to get breed specific, get a good definition, make it very clear what's enforceable and what's not.
Well, they're not asking for breed specific, they're asking for a blanket policy, if I'm correct, that ferocious or fish dogs. You just said breed specific.
Apologize, I did not mean that. It's not breed specific. So I think that's the way to go. But we need to take these and amalgamate these into one thing. They all have the same thing as increased penalties. I think we need some advice from the animal control and the police about what's enforceable here. How do we enforce this? And what's the, you know, how do we word this so it is enforceable? Is there a citizen portion to this that can assist?
I think there would have to be. I mean, I like your idea of, I mean, I think we're close, and I think the sides are, there's a base for a good change in our ordinance with both of these things combined. I'm not sure I'm in agreement with muzzling everybody, everything, everyone. Every dog. Maybe just the politicians we should muzzle. You know, I'm not sure, but I'd be willing to look at that. So I think you're right. I think we need to come up with something with our city attorney, and as far as an ordinance, come up with a combination of both of these and move it forward, and then maybe get some more public input on it. I mean, we've gotten a good feedback, and I thank everybody for doing that. I think there's room to discuss your option. I'm not in favor right now to go just say no. Every dog is muzzled. That's kind of where I am. Marty, did you have any thoughts?
Well, I know our ordinance needs some cleaning up in it because it does define some of these issues that we're talking about right now, but it doesn't give you a definition of what a vicious or dangerous dog is. So obviously that's one of the first things we need to do. Taking a look at our bond schedule, I think there's something we can improve in there. Let's make it a little bit tougher on animals at large and so forth. I think we're going to get some pushback from some dog owners that like to walk their dogs without leashes on that are very well behaved, but that's beside the point. I think we'll take a more aggressive approach on that, and that should clear that up. But I think if we go and come up with some good definitions, clean up this ordinance a little bit, I think it'll be something that we'd be able to enforce pretty regularly.
It's going to have to be awful tough for me to agree with it. I mean, it's going to have a lot of meat on it, and it's going to have to a lot of enforceability for me to support it.
But are you in agreement, yes or no, I guess, that we are close to combining something and coming up with a base to cleaning up our ordinance?
Since I don't have anything in front of me, I don't know the answer to that yet. I haven't seen anything other than that.
Well, the stuff that they presented and what we have, you know, to me, there's a base there. To get a good ordinance, one that's easy readable.
What I could do is I could start researching some definitions, working with Catherine on it, see if we can bring something back to the public safety that you might be able to agree with. Take a look at it from that perspective. Yeah. Talk to some of the chiefs throughout Wisconsin and see what they've done in their jurisdictions.
Yeah.
Yeah, for me it has to be something that makes the owners accountable and responsible, mm-hmm. and really has a lot of meat in it.
Well, the main issue is the violation and the penalties and what we do to the penalties.
Yeah.
And that's where we can come up with that. Marty, I guess if that's the direction we should go, then we would recommend that you would contact Catherine and move on with that for our next meeting.
Yep. I can bring it forward.
This is really an unpredictable issue, and I know that they say, you know, all these dogs are nice and pleasant and they're good pets, and you're a dog owner and you say that too, but as this one other person who spoke said, there are triggers, mm-hmm. and nobody really knows what that trigger is, and that's the concern I have about, you know, dogs not being muzzled or some freedom, you know, to harm someone. As a council person, if one child got maimed or injured or hurt, I would be very distraught and feel like we hadn't done our job. Just one. And I don't want to see that happen.
Good point.
Even if a dog has to be uncomfortable for me.
Mm-hmm. Make a good point. Any other thoughts or comments, Jim, Marty?
I guess they come to the point that I think dogs are basically better than people, you know, in terms of how they are and how they behave and how consistent they are. So we're punishing the dogs, and we should be punishing the owners. And that's the That's what I don't like about that approach. So.
Yeah, but I guess the our job then is to come up with a crafty penalty.
Right.
That will punish the owners.
But you know, we know that's not going to be 100%. And just look at the drunk driving laws. You know, no matter how harsh they are, how enforceable they are, how much they're enforced, you still have people that do it. So we're never going to be able to 100% proof this, except eliminate all the dogs from the city of Hudson. I mean, that's there you go. There's the solution. So we're not going to be able to present everything. We can just try to reduce it. We can do increased education. It breaks my heart when we take our dog for a walk and have kids to be afraid of her. You know, she's such a sweetheart and loves kids. You know, it was just, wow. You know, it was just harsh. Hated to see that. But understand it. You know, they've had bad experiences, or their parents have had bad experiences, and they bring that to do not touch dogs. And we have other parents who teach their kids to ask about dogs, and then they, you know, which is good education.
Yeah, it should make us all uncomfortable that kids in their own neighborhood can't even go outside without feeling scared, and that means we have to do a better job.
Yeah, that shouldn't be.
Yeah. So I think we kind of have a game plan. Did you need to hear anything else from the public?
Nope, I don't. Yeah.
Next meeting then, we will.
Which is, what, November? Is it the
4th? 5th or 6th.
Oh, no. Elections are that week. 13th.
Okay. Oh, it gets pushed out?
Yeah. Well, where was after the first council meeting? Since there's an election on the 4th, the council meeting got bumped.
All right. Well, I want to thank everybody for coming. You guys had great presentations, both of you. Thank you for all the comments that were made. And we will have this same conversation with hopefully kind of a base ordinance on the 13th of November, 6 o'clock. Thank you. Any other further business? Seeing none?
I guess the only thing I'd ask is if that lady would email the presentations. Is that the best way to get them?
I can scan them.
Angie Feller.
I got it.
Okay, never mind. Just to make sure you email everybody those things.
I have an idea too about how you can get more compliance with licensing. Dog park. I'm telling you, people will want to use it and they will have to get licensed in order to be a member. Find a place to make an off-leash dog park.
Okay, I'll move to adjourn.
I think they already said that.